Welcome to the future, where the glass is half full and you'll need new glasses, where you'll be jumping from conclusions.
The past is annulled, and a new future is born.
Never before in history has so much meant so little to so many. AD on the radio.
So let me get this straight, Funkhauser.
What?
You stole something from the Grammys?
I'm a thief.
Well,
thievery.
Perhaps we should back up a little bit, because I'm curious to know what you stole and the circumstances under which you stole it. But I suppose we should
really
play a little bit of catch up here and explain to you can explain to me. All I know is that I'm getting these pictures from Funkhauser. Here's Adele 2 feet away, and I knew kind of sort of that you had something to do with a Grammy broadcast. But what were you doing there?
Well, our parent company, the Grand Dragons of Talk Radio, have
Premier Radio,
pointed me toward the technical seat at the Grammys. So I was in the press room making sure that the lines were working and occasionally asking some questions.
You got to interview people?
Yeah, but I didn't expect that part to happen.
Did you have questions prepared?
I asked Cage the Elephant one question.
What'd you ask him?
I asked them if they bumped into anyone backstage that they were excited about.
And?
They bumped into Beyonce. Mm-hmm.
And they were excited about
Queen
that?
Queen B. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Hold on. Do you have Ain't a Rest for the Wicked?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Dig that up and play the very first line of the very first verse. There's a fascinating thing about Ain't No Rest for the Wicked. So wait, you're hanging out backstage. Would you dress up nice for this? Do you have to dress up nice? Do they demand that you're in tux and tails?
I wore a tie. I felt like I looked like a press guy. Combed my hair back like the 50s.
Did you have to be like, hi, Barry Funkhauser from Premier Radio Networks.
I did, yes.
Question for you.
I left my last name out on purpose. I'm just Mary from Premier. Let me ask you a question.
Listen to this. Okay.
Went out the corner of my eye, I saw a pretty little thing approaching me. She said, I never seen a man who looks so all alone. Could you use a little company? If you pay the right price, your evening will be nice and you can go and send me on my way. I said, you're such a sweet young thing, why you do this to yourself? She looked at me and this is what she said. Oh, there ain't no rest for
the wicked. You can kill it now, Funkhauser. So if you hadn't read between the lines of that song, if you've never taken a good listen to it, you can turn it all the way down.
In this world for free. What?
So in the first verse of Cage the Elephant's Ain't No Rest for the Wicked, the setup is this. The lead singer, Matt Schultz, is being solicited by a prostitute. A lady of the evening has approached him and said, hey, you want a little rumpy pumpy? It'll cost you for a certain amount of dollars. You can get all up in this. And he was like, why would you do something like that? That seems so incongruous to the type of person you look like. And apparently this is a true story. This actually happened to him. And he went home and he was so sort of affected by the situation that he sat down, wrote a song about it. Now, at the time he was writing Ain't No Rest for the Wicked, he was working as a plumber. That was his job. He was a plumber, and I think he worked in construction, and the whole being a rock star thing wasn't exactly going great guns. But that is the song that changed the game for Cage the Elephant. That is the song that broke them through to the world. That was their first single. That was the song that helped them get their record deal. Without that song, all the things that Cage the Elephant had become might have been absolutely nothing. And that song never would have been written had it not been for the fact that he was solicited by a prostitute one evening. So I wonder if there's any, and this is a bunch of guys that were hanging out at the Grammys with Funkhauser last night. This is a bunch of guys that can fill stadiums. This is a bunch of guys whose lives have been radically changed forever by the fact that they wrote that song, Ain't No Rest for the Wicked. So I wonder if at any point they've thought, maybe we should try and look up that prostitute that inspired the song that started everything for us and break her off some sort of royalty. I think they should.
There's your real winner.
Yeah, I think that's a moral imperative. But all right, so who else did you see?
I saw Adele. I saw Maren Morris, but I couldn't ask her a question. I was too starstruck because she's a country pop artist, and now I actually know who she is. I think I could have been the only person in the room, too, because a bunch of old press guys. Talking about your win there.
Could you, sneak into the performance area at all?
Oh, no. Oh, no. Our buddy Brian Gross was there, though. We got to see him. You know,
he's, oh, right on.
He's got a little, he had a suite because he's more famous than we are.
Because he's fancy?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you fancy, huh? Like, mm-hmm. I mean, I know that the Grammys aired last night, and I know that the big winner is me and anybody else who chose to watch Seinfeld reruns instead, because it's just a... I'm glad you had a good time, Funkhauser, but for the viewer at home, it's just this unnecessary orgy of self-congratulation. I'd rather watch the internet cliff notes the next day, which I'm going to do in a little bit, but I want to find out what the hell it was you stole, why and how you stole it.
For more stimulation and less irritation, 9 out of 10 doctors choose KPRC AM 950. Houston's more stimulating talk radio. Where the left and right come together for fundamental truths. AD on the radio. On Twitter at ADSXE.
Oh, there's a picture Funkhauser sent me. That's his view of Adele when he was working at the Grammys last night in the press group. You know, those shots look so glamorous. I guess this is where they give the speech to the press afterwards, after they've won stuff. Is this where this is, Funkhauser?
Oh, yeah. They get escorted up to the front of this thing with the logos, and they get three
on
or four
TV,
questions.
On TV, it looks like a really big deal. The picture you sent me is a bunch of, like, goofy-looking reporter guys and Adele looking as though she feels quite awkward standing in front of all of you. Everyone's, like, looking at their laptop, not her. It's like the winningest Grammy winner of all winners is standing there a couple feet away, and you're all checking your phones and looking at your computers. Like, she's like, I'm here now. I've won everything. Would you like to ask me questions about it? And nobody seems to care. Like, this picture, have you posted this picture online?
No,
I can't.
Give it a day or so. But Patton Oswalt was there, too, and he came up to answer questions while we were all having lunch.
Uh-huh.
So at the end, he's like, back to your carb diet sandwiches. Get back to your...
How did Patton Oswalt seem? Because, like, I mean, that horrible thing happened where his wife died a little while back, and he's sort of, like, getting back up in the game. He wrote something really touching about, he was like, this is my life. I'm going to have to go on stage and try and be funny at some point, and I'm going to do that soon. I'm not quite there yet. But he's out and about. How did Patton Oswalt seem? Because it's terrible the way he lost his wife.
Yeah, he did well. He did. He was pretty funny. I felt like, you know, he was on... He was in good spirits, and he did bring it up, saying that, you know, last year was a pretty bad year, but this year has been good so far, and we will see what happens. He hasn't started his next album yet, but he's working on working on starting.
This picture that you sent me of
Adele, right after she dropped the F-bomb,
like, no, it's just so telling because, like, from... You watch the stuff on TV, and it makes the Grammy winners look like the center of the universe. And there you are amongst a bunch of workaday journalists that are just trying to get some sort of soundbite or some sort of story. And not one of the people in this picture is actually looking at Adele. She looks awkward. She looks uncomfortable. And none of you people look like you're paying attention. It's so different from what you see on TV. This is really interesting to me. I skipped the Grammys because, you know, I'll watch the Cliff Notes online the next day. However, this, the nuts and bolts, the behind-the-scenes stuff is fascinating. Is it awkward, do you think, for, like, Adele to walk up there and have you all conspicuously not look at her?
Yeah, especially because we had one big question that no one got to answer, which was, what happened up there? Why did you stop in the middle of the George Michael tribute to start over? What happened there?
And nobody asked that?
She filibustered before anyone can ask, and then she's like, oh, I got three questions, right? Okay, am I done? Bye. And that was it. No one got to ask.
Well, what I heard was that, like, she'd said, hold on one second, because there were two big screw-ups at the Grammys last night. When your award show clocks in at over 3.5 hours, I suppose you can expect a couple of glitches. And there were two big ones at the Grammys. First one happened during Adele's tribute to George Michael. She was singing his 90s hit Fast Love, but it wasn't going too well, so she stopped. She said, I effed up. I can't do it again like last year. I can't mess this up for him. Do we have I think I've got the sound for that somewhere. That would be...
I have the unedited version in my head.
You have in your head? Hold on.
Remember the gasp in the press room when that happened?
All right, let's see. Let's roll the dice on this one. I don't know if it's censored or not. Hold on a second.
Let's just see the maybe you could help me ease my mind. I'm Mr. Right, but if you're looking for fast love, fast love.
Oh, it's painful.
I know it's live TV. I'm sorry. I can't do it again like last year. I'm sorry for swearing and I'm sorry for starting again. Can we please start it again? I'm sorry. I can't mess this up for him.
They say she started on the wrong note.
She started in the wrong key, but like what's amazing is she's perfectly, it's really hard to sing perfectly out of key, like consistently like that. Like she started in a different key and it's just like, which to me says that she's got perfect pitch. She knows exactly what key she's, or thought she knew what key she was supposed to be singing in and adhered to it no matter what the music in the background did. Like she was perfect, but just like a step up or a step down. You know what? And I kind of feel like that's what James Hetfield from Metallica should have done. Be like, hold on, hold, no, you're not doing me this way. Not again. No. And he didn't. He should have stopped the whole thing. But, you know, it's just like, all right, obviously, Adele's tribute to George Michael. She was singing that song, Fast Love. She stopped, swore, started over again, and pretty much nailed it. Adele had sound issues at last year's Grammy, too, just to give you the Grammys, too, to give you the backstory. And when she went on Ellen after the show, she said that next time it happened, she would stop and start over. And she did. She made good on her word. Then there was the much-hyped Metallica Lady Gaga duet, which should have rocked, and it did, except for one thing. James Hetfield's microphone didn't work for the first few minutes. Like,
you know, they fixed that in the replay. I got home to watch it, and, you know, if you were up at 11:50 last night, you probably saw it. They fixed it in post.
Did they really?
Mm-hmm. In the second airing, but it went out live.
Yeah, and nobody could hear him in the venue, right?
Mm-mm.
Yeah, him and Gaga are supposed to be trading verses, but his audio is non-existent, so it came off really bad until they fixed it. The band rocked, Gaga rocked, and
us metalheads in the press room were so mad.
Yeah, she showed her stomach again, so suck it, haters. after it was over, James was so angry, he threw his guitar off stage, and you know what? Yeah, F them. On the mic, can we play every day? And you're part of the bounce, you're out of time. Better act if you know. Whoa.
Real Radio. Yo. Real Radio. 104.1.
Don't get the blues, get all the news. We mean all the yous, guys out there in Radio Land.
All aboard!
He's back. AD on the radio.
Give it up, yeah. Give it up, yeah. Come on.
I'm just looking at Funkhauser's photos that he took at the Grammys. Thank you. Who's this band with the like all the long haired guys? Oh, that's Cage the Elephant?
I think so, yeah.
Oh yeah, no, I recognize them now. They are looking bearded. Very bearded. Wait, who's this guy in the enormous hat you sent me the video of? Is that George Michael?
That's a Latin pop.
I mean, sorry, my bad. Not obviously not George Michael. Is it Boy George?
No.
Everybody's wearing those giant hats now. Boy George and Pharrell were the first ones. And now it's quite the thing. So you stole something. You stole something from the Grammys.
Yes, I did.
Have you ever been backstage at the Grammys?
It's not like a theft like the last theft that we talked about here.
Ah.
A different kind of theft.
So, but, like, had you ever been in this position at the Grammys before?
No. I've been to the Staples Center before, but never at this kind of event.
All these pictures you're sending me, basically, are like a bunch of disinterested press guys looking at their laptops and their phones while, like, Grammy winners are on stage. And these are artists and musicians that are used to walking on stage, the curtain going up, and a million people screaming their heads off. And you guys couldn't seem like you give less of a crap.
But hey, don't loop me into that. I was very, very charismatic.
Well, I mean, but everyone's there doing a job and they're working at fever pitch. It's like, who's this? What'd they win? Okay, I got to get something from them. What can I Google something about them? What question can I ask them?
You would think, like, but there was like only five or six members of the press that said anything, and they were all like, so talk a little bit more about your win. It wasn't really anything special. They all went there for Adele. You could tell. Didn't care about most of them.
Right. So, this theft, Funkhauser.
I was going to say I'm ashamed, but I'm not ashamed. It's a theft by default. Mm. Okay, you see that picture with Adele there that I sent you? That we'll probably tweet out later.
Several
okay,
pictures.
Okay, so near her feet, there's something red. You see that there? So what they had there were bouquets of roses at the stage front. There's three of them. And at the end, we were closing down and wrapping things up, and I noticed one of the press guys had one of the bouquets. So I went over to him. I said, hey, man, how'd you get that there? He's like, oh, some guy was handing them out. I said, who's that guy? I would love to have one. I like flowers. They're all going to be thrown away anyway, right? And then he's like, I don't know where the guy is. Okay, fine. So I loiter for about 15 minutes afterwards, and everybody's tearing stuff down, and there's that one bouquet just sitting there looking at me. And I eventually find somebody with a walkie-talkie, and I go, hey, what's the story on those roses right there? That guy has a bouquet. What about this one? She goes, well, we're probably just going to throw them away anyway. I'm like, well, can you think I can, you know, take those with me? She's like, I ain't going to say anything. I go, I'm not gonna say anything.
I don't know if it's. I don't know if it's really theft if you ask permission.
Yeah, but I didn't.
Although I guess it. Yeah.
I asked it so that I could say, well, she told me I could.
Right.
So it's by technicality, I am a sort of a thief, with a lovely smelling apartment.
Do you think the flowers smelled better because they were close to Grammy winner Adele?
Maybe. Or worse, and Adele.
Do they smell
better.
Like fame / money?
Yes, I tried to price this out. I'm like, that's a $200 bouquet right there. I bet you. And it's Valentine's Day, and those are red roses. Good golly! So I gave it to my roommate. I told her I had a big surprise for her. I said, "Thank you for being my roommate. Here's a giant bouquet of flowers."
Yeah, God, wow. Did you say there were? Here's a giant bouquet of Adele's flowers.
Stolen Adele's.
Yeah.
Flowers.
I stole these from Adele, and they're for you. Oh my gosh, it's so much WTF though. Like, it really was. I mean, that's like the Grammys disrespect of rock is about as old as the Grammys are. Like, Metallica gets on, they don't have the microphone switched on, and it's basically it couldn't have summed up the Grammys disrespect of rock more perfectly. Like, it really, really was just absolutely freaking bananas. David Bowie won all four Grammys he was up for. There you go. Groundbreaking to the very last moment. I thought that was kind of cool. But, like, oh, gosh. Do you think that that Lady Gaga Metallica mashup thing that they did, do you think that was supposed to be part of the Super Bowl? Because for the longest time, and it just, like, again, it's sort of very, very sort of emblematic of a lack of respect that rock music gets in popular culture. You've got this band that has been filling stadiums and only stadiums since 1983 when they first started out. They had a number one album in 50 countries. And when they got on stage, they didn't even announce Metallica, did they? They just said Lady Gaga. So it made it look like Metallica were Lady Gaga's backing band, even though they were doing a Metallica song. Do you think, Funkhauser, do you think that this had something to do with the fact that they were supposed to do the Super Bowl with her? Because, like, it seemed as though she really knew the song. Credit where credit is due. It seemed like Lady Gaga really, really knew the Metallica song, which is a new one. It's not like something that she's had a chance to absorb through osmosis over the last 30 years that Metallica have been around. It was a brand new Metallica song off of the new album, and she knew it and knew it cold, knew every single word. And, you know, I mean, I guess learning one song isn't that big of a deal. However, just like how comfortable she was with it made me think, like, do you think they've been practicing this? Do you think maybe this was an idea that they practice this together and play at the Super Bowl together? Because, like, that was the thing with the Red Hot Chili Peppers. When the Chili Peppers played it, again, you would think Red Hot Chili Peppers, this band that had been around since the 80s, that has been playing stadiums and only stadiums for over 20 years, you would think that they would maybe get their own Super Bowl halftime show. But no, they have to be Bruno Mars' guests. Bruno Mars invited them, and I have a feeling that Lady Gaga invited Metallica, and that got shut down. And that's when they wound up doing it at the Grammys instead. That's my best guess. Right. Did you hear any scuttlebutt about that?
No, I just, a lot of angry metalheads when the mic didn't work. That's about where it came down to. And we thought we'd talk to them. But we did talk to, who's Dave Mustaine a member of? He came to the press room.
Dave Mustaine is a member. You know what's interesting? The guy who I think won a Grammy for the Megadeth album, this guy Josh, who I think either produced it or mixed it or something, he was when he was just starting out in the studio business, was one of the guys that I worked with back in the day. I was like, no kidding, Josh is like winning Grammys for Megadeth records now. But yeah, no, Dave Mustaine sings in Megadeth, but back in the day he played guitar in Metallica. He was like one of the first members of Metallica. Then he got kicked out, and he still kind of hasn't gotten over it, because he could have been a gazillionaire.
He had a little awkward question.
He's just a multimillionaire. Yeah.
In the press room, somebody asked him a political question. He goes, I keep getting in trouble. I don't want to ask that. No political questions for me.
One of my first sort of like forays into the world of politics, I remember being a little kid and loving Megadeth and seeing that Megadeth were a part of... Dave Mustaine was hosting MTV's coverage of the Republican National Convention, I think. Like, because he was known as being the sort of cerebral thinking man's metal guy. And so he was sent to be a political correspondent for MTV. It's like, so, and now he gets in trouble sort of thing. So he decides to stay away from it. Did it seem to you as though a lot of people just stayed away from politics? Everyone was like, man, this is just going to be artists and musicians and rock stars and celebrities sounding off about politics. And it seemed like people pretty much, for the most part, stayed away from it.
Yeah, I thought there would be more, actually. More people saying things, but there wasn't. It was...
Do you think... And you were there. Maybe you got a sense for it. Like, maybe it was palpable. You were there. Do you think that there's a sense now that people are just sick of politics, sick of arguing about politics?
Yeah, I think so. There was a different feeling in the air when a couple of, you know, Sturgill Simpson won for Best Country, and that was a wild card. And Chance the Rapper won a lot of stuff, and a lot of people didn't know who he was before then. So, like, everyone was excited about the horizon of music to come.
I think, you know what, and I think, like, music is this great uniter. When we
Busta
talked to...
Busta was there, though, and he talked about...
What did he
Agent
call?
Agent Orange.
Didn't he called him Agent Orange. But I don't know. Like, I remember talking to the guys from Metallica right before the record came out when we had them on the show. And what was kind of interesting was I was like, okay, reading between the lines, you know, like songs with lyrics like we're all effed, straight out of luck. Is that in reference to any sort of political situation? You know, like, are you taking... And they were just very straight up about it. They're like, when you're an artist or a musician, 9 times out of 10, you're drawn off the energy around you. And the energy around us, you know, dictated that we spoke about some of this stuff. It wasn't Metallica talking necessarily about who they were going to vote for. It wasn't Metallica talking about politicians being right or wrong on certain policies. However, it was them sort of like taking the temperature of the country and giving a representation of how they felt and how their audience felt with their new album. So there was sort of like a very sort of political bent to it. And it was interesting because I think that Metallica hit the nail on the head with that. Metallica, rather than posturing, rather than saying, I'm right, you're wrong, if you disagree, you're an evil a-hole that hates America, Metallica just sort of translated the feelings around them and put them into their music. And it had nothing to do with a Republican or a Democrat thing, but it went, hey, people are upset, people are angry, people are feeling a certain kind of way about this right now, and our music is going to reflect that. And that was, you know, a couple months back. And now I think it's just taken a couple short months. It's taken a couple weeks of someone's presidency, and all of a sudden people seem so fatigued on it. Some of like my very best friends who are incredibly politically minded love to, you know, banter about politics in person, love to sound off about politics online, have been sort of saying, like, you know, I really miss the good old days when all my friends and I used to argue about was which bar we were going to go get drunk at. I really miss the good old days when we argued about sports. I really miss the good old days when we argued about which band had a better guitar player, which band put on a better live show. It's an interesting one because everybody was expecting the Grammys to be this full-on uber political thing, and I think that peaked. I mean, I'm sure it's going to come back, but I think that peaked at the Golden Globes. I think that was people going, okay, all right, Meryl Streep, Donald Trump are fighting. That's it. None of this affects anything. None of this changes the way anybody feels. None of this is productive. All of it eats away hours and hours of our lives that we're never, ever getting back. And you know what? The fact that, like I said, I think the big winner is of the Grammys, anyone like me who chose to watch reruns of Seinfeld instead. The temperature seems like people are kind of like over it. And I think that's a very productive thing. It's great to be involved. It's great to be a part of your community. It's great to be a part of a participatory democracy. But when you start giving up large chunks of your life in support or detraction of a politician that does not know your name, wouldn't know you if they ran you over in the street, it's sort of time to reassess some of your priorities. What were you saying, Funkhauser?
I forget.
You got to hold on to these thoughts.
I should have written it down. It'll come back to you, me.
Yeah, yeah, you probably should have. Mm. There you go. Oh, man.
Oh, how many awards did they give out last night? To take a wild guess, how many do you think in that 3.5 hour show, how many awards did they give out? Without, you might know, but how many do you think? Just take a wild guess.
Wild guess?
Mm-hmm. I guess 10.
I mean, there's categories that you've never even heard of, like best mic placement.
No, just the ones they gave out on TV.
Oh, just the ones they gave out on TV?
Yeah.
3.5 hours, bunch of performances. They give out like 25 on TV, something like that.
Nine. Only nine.
Only nine.
Can you believe it?
Yeah. Only. And how many do you know how many total? Like, we saw nine given away on TV.
Guys. So there was a pre-award ceremony that I had to sit through that was 4 hours long, and they gave out 75 awards in that one. 75.
In just the pre-awards ceremony.
And just hosted by Margaret Cho. Yeah, it was a good time. It was 75 rocket fire acceptance speeches.
And that's just the pre-show. They gave away nine on TV. There were 75 before the pre-show. And that's like, I mean, the Grammys get pretty in-depth. It's like best microphone placement on a bunch of Outer Hebrides-based nose flute music. Like, that's an award. They go deep on that stuff. So there's no way they could get them all on TV. However, in a 3.5 hour award ceremony, you think you could cover more than nine?
Real radio. Real radio. 104.1. Now, more AD on the radio.
So, love is in the air, but as you and I know, love can be a difficult thing. Love can be a difficult thing, even when you're not anything to do with it, as I found out in my early days in radio. I'll never forget, like,
what does love have to do with it?
Well, very little. Love can be a tough and unpleasant thing at times. Love has nearly gotten me stabbed more than once.
More than once?
Well, we won't go into all the reasons, but the one that sticks in my brain, the one that sticks in my brain as we stare down the barrel of a Valentine's Day, is right when I first started in radio. I was taking calls, getting prize winners. I don't even know what the hell it was I was doing. I don't. But I picked up a call from some woman who had won something or had a question, and we chit-chatted for a little bit, and I honestly don't know to this day what this woman's deal was. We talked 5 minutes tops, I think. That was it. Never laid eyes on this person before. Never met her in person before. Never had any idea what type of... That was it. That was the extent of my conversation with her. Hey, you gonna play new Metallica? Also, your caller 10, you win this. Like, that was it. 5 minutes tops. Don't know what chain of events this set off in this woman's mind, but she read significantly more into our little conversation than I did or any normal person would, because a little while later, I start getting angry emails from her husband.
Uh-oh.
Who said he knew all about our plans to leave, for us to run away together and leave him and their kids behind. I was like, look, no disrespect to the woman that you married. I don't knew. It took me a while to figure this out. Like, who the hell it was. You know, she won these tickets from you, and now, you know, you're running away together. No. I was like, no disrespect to the woman that you chose to spend your entire life with. But I don't know where she got that from. I've never met her. Corresponded with her. Don't know. Not a thing. And, like, this was a guy that was going to inflict grievous bodily harm on me. And, like, we get into it a little bit, and I was just like, look, I'm sorry, but you gotta believe me here. I don't know who your wife is. I've never met her, and I'm certainly not planning on running away with her and leaving you with four hungry kids or however the hell many you got. Sorry, you do have you got a situation that you obviously have to address in your marriage, but I'm not part of it in any way, shape, or form. So it can be a difficult thing when love comes crashing through your door and almost ends your life in the way it did with mine and in the way it did with Doug Millard.
Valentine's Day. Anybody? Anybody love Valentine's Day? Who here hates Valentine's Day? Yes! Yes! These are my people! Woo! Yes! I hate that. If Cupid were here, I'd rip off his wings and punch him in the diaper. Let's go. Yeah. Let me tell you why I hate Valentine's Day. Because a few years ago, on Valentine's night, I thought I would have a nice romantic evening in with a lady. But little did I know that same night, her ex-boyfriend thought he would try to win her heart back. And being the sweet, romantic guy that he is, he thought the best way to do this would be to get all coked up. And then jump through a window and try to murder me. Don't woo that. I know you fellas are thinking, like, why didn't I think of it? I know. There's always next year. Because you know what? It works. They're still together. It's great. Don't feel sorry for me, though, because, you know, I got a cash settlement out of the deal. And I'll tell you this right now. Getting stabbed actually pays better than comedy. So...
Just barely.
So, yeah. Valentine's can be difficult. Hopefully you remember that tomorrow is Valentine's Day. That's step one. Now we'll get into the rest of the steps that it takes to half-ass tomorrow, but not make it super obvious. Here are the results from a survey by... What would you say is the ultimate sign that you're half-assing something at Valentine's Day? Funkhauser?
The ultimate sign?
Yeah.
Oh, man. That you just completely forget it? Don't yeah. show up,
or just, you know,
you ghost out on the Valentine's Day.
Well, I mean, not ghost out, but like, what's the bare minimum?
Oh, here's I made you a gift certificate for one yeah. free back rub for later.
Yeah. Oh, that is gift certificate.
Is that too much work?
For a back rub? that is kind of yeah. No, the I would say that if you roll up to Valentine's Day with a Groupon in hand, that is where you know you've gone badly wrong. And interestingly enough,
honey, I got this two for one.
Yeah.
Because it's two of us and we should be one today.
The breadsticks and salad at Olive Garden are now even more unlimited. We can go back.
Here, honey, this doggy bag is for you. Oh, just for you. I promise I won't eat out of it.
Here you go. New wiper blades. You needed these. And I know you like lemon scented. Did you buy all these at the gas station at 12 o'clock tonight? Yes. Yes, I did.
But that doesn't mean you don't need them.
Oh, man. You ever hear... keep the music up. That's great. Do you ever hear Kevin James, you know, King of Queens guy, that guy, talk about, like, buying a Valentine's card? Mm. He does a great bit on it where he talks about, like... He was like, don't forget and leave the receipt in the bag as well. Like, because it goes from, oh, you remembered you got me a card to... Wait a second, you bought a Butterfinger first, you fat ass. Anyways, here are the results from a survey by Groupon. when you really want to get the message across that you tried as little as possible. Here are the results from a survey by Groupon that figured out the bare minimum amount of effort you need to put in to make it look like you tried on Valentine's Day. All right, you know how they say you can't buy love? That you can't assign a dollar amount to emotions? Wrong! Apparently you can. What would you say is the bare minimum you gotta spend on Valentine's Day to make it look as though you cared, Funkhauser?
Oh, $9.99.
We'll get into it next. No, a little bit more.
Boy, you should talk a bunch, but then I've got a hunch that if I step to you, you'd back right down. Can't see it through your bitch and you're like Kool-Aid. You're just 10% juice. Punk.
Leave the stimulation to the professionals.
Everyone is so smart.
KBRC, more stimulating talk radio.
There's something happening here, and you should know what it is.
The dumbing up of America. Now, more AD on the radio.
So, here would be the bare minimum amount of effort you need to put in to make it look like you tried on Valentine's Day. According to a new survey by the folks over at Groupon, this is what you got to do. Now, like I said, you think that you can't put a dollar amount on love? Apparently you can't. Yeah, apparently you can. What would you say is the bare minimum you got to spend, Funkhauser, if you want to make it appear as though you cared?
Well, I said $9.99, but Rose, they hike up the price on all of the special things then. So I'm going to say less under $25.
If you're a man, the bare minimum that's going to make it look like you care, spend $179 on gifts and dinner.
Mm-hmm. What?
Yeah. $179 on gifts and dinner. That's like, and it, like $178, you clearly don't care. You insensitive a-hole.
Well, you throw dinner in there, and then that totally changes things.
I mean, yeah. No, it's gifts and dinner. It's not like, that's the whole shebang. If you're a woman, you got to spend $74.
Oh, yeah?
Now, when it comes to the card, Funkhauser, are you an eloquent individual with this sort of thing?
An eloquent individual? Like, do I pick the right card? No.
Do you pick the right card? Do you write just the perfect sentiment in that card? Are you good at...
I just draw my name in an X and an O.
That's it?
Yeah. Write thanks.
Thanks? Thanks for letting me see you naked sometimes. I appreciate the opportunity to touch your boobs. You got to write at least four sentences in the card. Four sentences. So right now, if you're looking to do the absolute bare minimum,
that's
bear in mind, if you're a guy, you got to write four sentences in a card and spend $179 on gifts and dinner combined. And even if you're planning a night out, make sure to buy some gift, even a small one, just like a date will not do. 26% of women and 19% of men would be disappointed if they didn't get anything. So, there you go. And make sure to plan some kind of activity, even if it's just dinner at home. 71% of people say it's more important that you plan something than what it is specifically. Are you a good plan maker, Funkhauser?
Oh,
like, I've got a surprise for you. Like, Funkhauser, honestly, is sort of like... you go through Los Angeles with Funkhauser, and he knows everything about every place. He can tell you historically significant pieces of information about every block of Los Angeles. You know about every restaurant. You know about every places, every scenic view. I would imagine you're probably good with the planning.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's home, you know. And being in radio, you learn dumb things all day long. Uh-huh. So I remember.
Like, have you ever done that? Like, I decided to take you to this special place where the Black Dahlia murder was committed.
Oh, yeah. You see that? Brad Pitt lives there. You want to go knock mm-hmm. on his door? You can't. Mm.
Happy Valentine's Day. Here's your map to Stars Homes. Oh, my gosh. All right. Well, now that we've covered doing the absolute bare minimum that makes it look as though you cared on
count?
Valentine's Day.
Like, did this count for our bare minimum? Just saying it?
Just talking about it on the air?
I mean,
I don't think so.
Some girls out there, I think.
I think we probably help some guys not blow it with girls. I don't know. Valentine's Day is, do you think that's a lot of pressure? I mean, like, this is a conversation as old as the holiday itself, but do you think it's unfair pressure put on a relationship where the guy has to, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I think in the social media world, absolutely, because whatever you do is going to get shared.
I deeply resent the timing of Valentine's Day. I really, really do. If they had it in September or June or some other, like, but look, you've just burnt up all your creativity and thoughtfulness on getting the perfect holiday gift. You know, like, I came up with a perfect Christmas thing.
Yeah, you still remember Christmas.
But yeah, yeah. Like, you're just like, I just did that for Christmas. Now I gotta come up with something. I mean, I listen. I know what she wants. I'm aware of the things that, you know, she feels like her life needs, but I got them all for Christmas. Like that book that she's been talking about for a little while, tickets to that show she wanted to see, like the type of candy that she likes that you can only get back home where she's from and you can't get it. Like, I did all that stuff, but I did it a month and a half ago, and now I'm effed because I got nothing left in the tank. Like, I need another 6 months of listening to be able to build up to getting just the right gift. So I deeply resent the timing of Valentine's Day. I think Valentine's Day is a great idea. Like, if you're in love, if you're with someone, take a moment to celebrate the awesomeness that is your relationship. Take a moment to celebrate your love. Look, we all live lives that go a million miles an hour at all times. We all live these lives where we have tons of responsibilities. You got your bills you got to pay. You got your job you got to do. You got to go home after work. You got to go back to work the next morning, get a bite to eat somewhere in between. And, you know, in a routine like that, which all of us in America are living at the moment, it's easy. It's easy for the relationship to get lost. It's easy to sort of forget why it is that you're with that person in the first place. It's easy to let that stuff take a back burner. And if you do that, you're kind of missing out on what makes life awesome and worth living in the first place. All that stuff that you put yourself through, all that hassle that you put yourself through so you can support a family and any kids that you might happen to have and maybe provide a nice home and do all the things that you do to try and make your life as good as possible for the person that you're with. So often you get so caught up in all of that that you miss out on why you're doing it in the first place. Hopefully you found this person, that person's a special person, and you work really hard to give the best that you can to the people that matter the most, and that includes them, but you lose sight of it. And so a lot of people will dismiss Valentine's Day as a, you gotta kill the music, Funkhauser. This is like,
I'm so immersed now in love and roses.
Yeah, no, you're really not. Like, I'm seriously. But you get so wrapped up. You get so wrapped up in, like, trying to keep up with this life that you have with the person that you're with that you kind of, like, forget to enjoy the good stuff. Why you're doing all that work in the first place. And so, for that reason, I think Valentine's Day is a great idea. I mean, in theory, you should have those moments that you create all the time, but a little reminder isn't bad. Just like, Christmas isn't a bad reminder of peace on earth, goodwill toward all. These are wonderful things. And, you know, a holiday that makes you think about that a little bit more than you usually would, I am all in favor of. But putting it a month and a half after you've used up all your good gift ideas at Christmas time, F you, Hallmark, F you.
Unless you use Amazon and, like, time delay one gift around Christmas.
Have you ever done this? Well, no, like, time delay one gift for Christmas. Yeah. Have you ever, like, bought a bunch of Christmas gifts for your Sweetie Pie Funkhauser and thought, like, I'm holding one of these back for Valentine's Day?
Yeah, like, but I do it with, like, Amazon. Like, don't deliver this until February 10th, and then I forget. So it's a gift for
right.
both of us. Oh, wow.
It's a gift for...
I was so thoughtful.
I was so thoughtful, yeah. Here I was worried what to get her for Valentine's Day, and I got this. I'm awesome. I forgot. But I actually... I've talked to a bunch of guys that do that, that'll like... They'll like do their Valentine's and their Christmas shopping in one go. And like it becomes a struggle going like, which one am I going to hold back for Valentine's Day? This one's really sweet and romantic and I want to give it to her for Christmas. However, it's going to make anything I give her for Valentine's Day look quite pedestrian. So I gotta figure out which to hold back. Yep. It's a lifelong struggle. Funkhauser.
That's why you just steal flowers. From some event. Or just ask real nicely. Hey, do you know who?
Yeah, do like Funkhauser did. Steal flowers from the Grammys that were at the feet of Adele to give to your lesbian roommate who isn't interested in you because she's a lesbian, but is, at the same time, kind of attractive.
Just tell him it was your secret admirer and we'll both get points.
How's it going for your lesbian roommate at Valentine's?
Oh, yeah. It's nice. Oh, yeah. Look at her. She's putting on all that black makeup.
No. What? No, ding dong. I'm not asking about your creepy habits regarding her. I'm asking about, like, does she have a significant other in her life?
No. It's the same that goes for us, dude. People that are dating, they just ghost out this week. They disappear.
So, like, she doesn't have a girlfriend?
She doesn't have a specific girlfriend. She's got a couple.
She has an embarrassment of riches.
Yeah.
Hold on. So let's just paint the picture here. Okay. You have a lesbian roommate that has several girlfriends.
Loves Morrissey.
Loves Morrissey and has several girlfriends. However, she bails on these several girlfriends close to, she kind of ghosts and's like, I've got stuff to do. I've been really busy.
No. She's out of the country. It's the other way around.
Oh, they ghost out on her.
Yeah. Well, cause I live with her. So I get all the information.
So she has the embarrassment of riches of having multiple lesbian partners that occasionally come over to your house.
Yeah. But I think she also ghosts out on them too. So it's a two-way street.
Right. It's a two-way street.
Equal
people don't want the hassle. People don't want the hassle of the commitment. So you wind up feeling alone, but at the same time, you don't have to deal with a gift. You just spend Valentine's Day alone going, they should have called me. And meanwhile, they're going, you should have called me. Interesting. Mm-hmm. Interesting. Mm-hmm. So wait, hold on. She has multiple lesbian girlfriends. Do they all come over to the house? Does she bring them home for you to vet?
For me to vet?
Yeah.
I don't think she cares about a couple of them.
Extreme vetting in place?
They have very firm handshakes. Try to high-five everyone. Hey, what's up?
So, all right, would you argue that...
The revolving door at my house.
In Cro-Magnon gender roles, right? Mm-hmm. You know, like, I think that most guys would agree that on a Valentine's Day, there's a bit more pressure on the guy to come up with the goods. Is that fair? Again, I'm not saying this is what I believe. I'm not diminishing the role of women in relationships. I'm just saying that society as a whole tends to put more pressure on the man in this situation of Valentine's Day, right?
Yeah, I think so. I think you're dead on there. Mm-hmm.
So, in a lesbian relationship, lesbian Valentine's Day, who's got to do the most?
Valentine's Day. It depends on a lot of things.
Well, you know,
I know a couple of things. Yeah, it's like,
what do you know? I know nothing.
She always feels that she has to pay when she takes.
I'm
a girl
banging
out.
Two rocks together trying to make a fire. Like, I know nothing.
Well, you're so close there with the rocks.
Oh God. Very good, Funkhauser. Very good. All right. What do you know? She feels she has to pay.
It depends on the scenario. It depends on the introduction, how the relationship goes from the beginning. Like, It's like, you know, she'll go out with a girl and think that she has to pay because she asked the girl out. And I'm like, I don't know if it works that way. You know, I think you can.
You know, I would say that is a good rule of thumb. I think a lot of guy girl relationships work that way too. If she asks you out. She should probably pay. That's the evolved thing to do. Like,
yeah, but not every time. The first time.
Right. So, but she feels she has to pay if she asks a girl out. That makes perfect sense. And that was easier to get to the bottom of than I thought it would be. What else do you know?
What else do I know? that she goes through the same things we go through when that it comes to, like, you know, second date, third date, how to text, how to deal with somebody who's social mediaing with her other girlfriends.
Uh-huh.
And how you're supposed to deal with it. And how to go to the club with a girl.
Interesting. I do not go to the club, so that is not, like,
I hear about it. If you have any questions, I can ask her later.
Maybe we can get her on the show.
Oh, you don't want that to happen.
Oh, we're all at a show, and thankfully, no burning questions. I find that one of the great unseen upsides of an inability to attract women into your bed is that you deal with less itchy burning sensations in intimate areas. It's good times. Hey, happy almost Valentine's Day, everybody.